Hobbs, you're locked on BBC Radio 6 Music, and I am absolutely delighted to welcome Tom Morello to the programme today. Tom, hello.
Hi, thanks very much for having me.
It's been like 20 years or something since I've seen
you. That's what you just said. Yeah, it's been a while.
And a man in a Moomin t-shirt. I mean, you've clearly come dressed for the job today.
Well, an anti-fascist Moomin t-shirt.
So fabulous.
It's all in the wardrobe. So.
You're here today to actually to play some music that's perhaps a little bit unlikely, stuff from your record collection that people may not anticipate that you may have buried away in the recesses.
That's what I was asked to do. Yeah.
What are we going to go in with?
All right, we're going to start with a Leonard Cohen track called You Want It Darker off of his Swan Song record. And I've always aimed for a spiritual quality in my guitar playing. And I think there are a number of different ways to touch an audience in a way that goes beyond, oh, I like that song, or, oh, that's an impressive technique. And people do it in different ways. You know, Jimi Hendrix did it in his way. Kurt Cobain did it in his way. Leonard Cohen does it in a like mainline spirituality in his lyrics and in his delivery. He's, as a lyricist, he's competitive with Dylan. As a songwriter, he's, you know, in my top five favorites of all time. And this is a song where he's staring his own mortality in the face. And while I've always been drawn to heavy music, sometimes I think that the right couplet and the right piano chord can be just as heavy as anything coming out of a Marshall stack, as we will hear here, right here on Leonard Cohen's You Want It Darker.
With You Want It Darker, as selected by my very special guest on 6 Music, Tom Morello. What a beautiful, low, rich baritone that is.
Yeah, there are very few singers that are in that range, and there are certainly none that have the poetic depth of Leonard Cohen in that vocal range. And it's for someone like myself who has never been able to hit the high notes, it's very encouraging that there's someone like Leonard Cohen in the world who is able to sort of justify the baritone voice.
Yeah, what a way to kind of sail from this mortal coil as well.
Sure. I mean, an incredible career, an incredible final record. And we were talking earlier about how this record was actually made in his front room, recorded by his son. I think his Leonard's health was failing, that the way that they were able to record him was just in a very intimate setting in his home. And it's Leonard Cohen is not an artist or a person who we should weep for. He led a great life and left an incredible legacy of music that people can enjoy forever.
Yeah, he certainly did. What about you? I hear you're writing some new material.
Sure. Right, well, Prophets of Rage, we had a song come out recently called Made with Hate, mm-hmm. Sort of commenting on the continually brewing chaotic storm that is the United States of America and the normalization of hate. And we continue to work on songs in this day and age, like, we talk among ourselves about, like, what does an album mean? There used to be sort of one way to do it. You would write an album, you'd record an album, you'd do 6 months of promotion, and then the record would kind of, you know, X, Y, and Z. In this day and age, it's really, the process has become democratized in a way that the healthy side of that, I think, is that there's more music available all the time, and there are no barriers. Like, music is cheaper than water now, you know, so there's no barriers to accessing the music. However, it's such a white noise background of so much all the time that finding the crystalline gems within it is a more difficult process than perhaps it was once.
Yeah, that's so true. So what's your plan? Are you just going to kind of scattergun?
Yeah. Well, we have a timely, you know, in light of the recent gun violence in the United States, we've got a very timely song that we're going to put out in the next, hopefully next couple of days. And then beyond that, I think for Prophets of Rage, you know, this will be our third studio record, and really the one where I think we have to define who we are in 2019 and beyond, rather than just sort of a coming together of groups with notable catalogs to really find our own sound and to continue to grow. When the band came together in 2016, it was a reaction to the chaotic U.S. election cycle, and we thought it was we had to do more than tweet about it. And so we have these, you know, a lot of great arrows in our quiver when it comes to songs. And so by putting this group together, it was a way to kind of move the goalposts and address the issues of the time, you know, to, you know, between 2,000 and 60,000 people a day. And now it's time to really get that musical message on tape.
Yeah, I understand that. The idea that actually you have a certain amount of ideas that you can propagate digitally, but at some point it really has to coalesce.
That's correct. Yeah. I think, and while there's, you can put out, your ballad on Tuesday, an acoustic song on Wednesday, and your heavy metal, and it's in a way that there used to be much more constrained lanes that you had to stay in. I think it's very, very important for us, sort of given our histories and the fact, like for me, the next Prophet's record will be the 20th album of my recording
career.
Yeah. And so it's, like the shows have been as exciting musical events as any that I've been involved in my entire career on this last European tour. And so we want to, strike when the iron's hot.
For sure. Yeah. I hear that. Should we play another tune?
Sure. Let's do one.
What's it going to be?
Okay. This one is evidence that in order to be great, one must be authentic. This is a song by Gogol Bordello called Ultimate. And Gogol Bordello is the self-described gypsy punks and a band that has, varies in number, I think, between sort of 7 and 11. And I don't think there are two of the same passports within the band. It's Ukraine and Colombia, United States, and here the Ethiopia. And their music is very much a global amalgamation, but with a real sort of defining North Star of uncompromising personal freedom, liberated love, and anarchistic politics.
If we are here. Hello, selected by Tom Morello on BBC Radio 6 Music. That is absolutely riotous.
Yeah, that's probably the hardest rocking song featuring a, I don't know what instruments are playing there. An accordion. That's the hardest rocking accordion song of all time.
Yeah.
I would wager.
And they supported you once, right?
Yeah. We've a number of times had the good fortune to share the stage. And they're one of those bands that, in a live setting, every band I've been has always been competitive. You never want to be the second best band on a bill. And when you play with Gogo Bordello, you got to watch yourself. Because they will bring some heat. And we had during the Rage reunion era, we played a show with them in Portugal. And afterwards, we invited the motley crew of Gogo Bordello back to the hotel. And all of the staff and the patrons were looking sideways at these guys. First of all, sort of the militantly political Rage Against the Machine dudes, and then the sort of the crazy Ukrainian gypsy people, and they said the hotel bar's closed. We have a nice room for you over here. You can stay in there as long as you want. As long as you stay in there. And we had a lovely time playing guitars till dawn.
Yeah, right.
Great band. Yeah.
Of course, I guess one of the moments that we love the best about your history with Rage Against the Machine is the fact that there was an entire movement created in your name in the UK, and you took down Simon Cowell.
Sure. Well, I wouldn't say that we took down Simon Cowell. I would say the people of the UK took down Simon Cowell. It was the for the Christmas number one, which is now coming up to its 10th anniversary, I believe. This year will be the 10th anniversary. And it was an extraordinary event where we were just going about our lives in Los Angeles, and some friends of mine in the UK texted me and said, "Do you know what's going on?" I have no idea. And they said, "We didn't know what X Factor was. We knew who Simon Cowell was. We didn't know what X Factor was." And we learned that it was this rigged system where they had this TV show, and then someone wins the stupid TV show, and they sing the song, and then everyone buys it the next day. It's the Christmas number one. They all pat themselves on the back, right? But a suburban London couple who was actually at the show, Prophet's Rage show last night, John Morter and his wife.
Fantastic.
The Morters made a Facebook campaign that to dethrone the X Factor, and it is the Guinness Book of World Records it's the song most downloaded in 1 week in history, Killing in the Name, and it stands as quite a high watermark, despite the fact that our record company, which was Sony UK, did everything to make us lose, because they also represented Simon Cowell and they knew which side their bread was buttered. They didn't return the band's phone calls or emails, because we were like excited, like, oh, what, this 17-year-old song might be number one. Dead silence.
Wow.
Dead silence from them. And despite the fact we had no physical copies of it in stores, you could not buy it in a store. You had to download it. It was almost 600,000 downloads in 1 week of the song, and we crushed them, and it was awesome.
It was a beautiful moment.
It was. Then we played the free show at Finsbury Park, which to this day stands as my favorite live performance of my life.
Really?
It's fantastic, yeah.
Yeah. What are we going to play next time?
We're going to play a song, I was always opposed physically and diametrically opposed to EDM music through much of my life. To me, it always sounded like Italian taxi cab music in the worst possible way. And then a friend of mine who I was working on one of my solo records more recently, and he said, "You always hate EDM music. Let me play you some stuff that you haven't heard." And he played me a group called Knife Party. And I immediately heard, and while there wasn't a guitar in sight in the band, I heard the same kind of tension and release of some of my favorite rock and roll. And there were some of the fingerprints of bands like Rage Against the Machine in the music, except it was made with synthesizers rather than with electric guitars. And I was like, this is as hard as anything I've ever heard. It's fantastic. And then when I wanted to make my next record, the Atlas Underground record, which came out almost a year ago, and I found all these artists who had grown up on groups like Rage Against the Machine, had incorporated some of the styles of writing music and arranging music, but had used their own sonic vocabulary to engage with some of those artists and say, hey, let's now use your production techniques, but replace your electronics with my analog Marshall Stack electric guitar. That's what the Atlas Underground record is. But the first Knife Party song I heard is the one we're going to listen to now. It's called Centipede. And you will hear in this song like the same field bouncing anthemic qualities that make for some of my favorite rock and roll. And this was the song that set me on the journey to making the Atlas Underground record. Centipede by Knife Party.
I was selected by Tom Morello, who's my very, very special guest. Tell us the story of the amp. And the microphone, or absence of.
So a couple of years ago, I was playing with Knife Party. We did a song called Battle Sirens on my record, The Atlas Underground. We were performing that song, which is the alloy of the analog Marshall Stack and the digital Knife Party bass drop. So they push my amp out for the song, and we're ready to count the song in. It's ready. Here we go, and we're going to rock them all. It's going to be the debut of the song, and it's very, very exciting. But their crew doesn't mic amplifiers, so my mic was unamped, and it was, and we're, you know, 14 seconds from the countdown, I'm like, there's no mic on the amplifier, please fix that. And you know, some roadie comes from the shadows with they dust off microphone. They dust off a Shure microphone, and it all went smashingly well. There's plenty of YouTube evidence that it went great, but for the moment it was panic city.
Yeah. Just before we kind of cast you away into the night, I wanted to ask one question, actually. We've been playing Audioslave's music run-up to you arriving for this particular piece. And I just wanted to ask you about your memories of Chris Cornell.
Sure. I mean, you know, Chris was a great friend and one of the most tremendous singer-songwriters, not just in rock or grunge, but of all time. And, you know, while he was a friend and a bandmate, I never stopped being a fan of Chris and his voice and his work. And it is a bottomless tragedy from which I will never recover. And there's no, you know, there's no real explanation at the end of the day why he passed. And so, you know, we enjoy his music. We salute him at our show. And we do, like on this tour, we've been doing like an instrumental version of Cochise, where we just light the microphone and then the crowd sings it. And it's really, you know, it's a way to sort of, I don't know if heals the right word, but sort of celebrate him and mourn him collectively. And I just can't believe he's gone. It's so crazy. It's so crazy. You know, it's like, you know, for a guy who, you know, what I will say about Chris, though, is that he's a person that had demons from a very young age. You know, had addictions and demons from a very, very young age. And he was somehow managed to harness them to make some of the greatest rock and roll music of all time. And so that, I think, was perhaps his greatest gift to us, was to take the stuff inside that was the turmoil and the hurt and the stuff that was not okay, and somehow forge that into, you know, many records of tremendous music and vocals and singing and guitar playing and whatnot. So
yeah, I guess all of us miss him very, very much.
Yeah, it's a like I said, it's a bottomless. We shan't recover from that one. But I mean, it's not a silver lining. His music is always there. It is always there. And yeah, Brad and I are actually just talking about Chris. We talk about him all the time. You know, it's like he's his presence is there, and certainly at every one of our shows, you know, I think about him.
Yeah. Well, listen, thank you so much for being with us today.
Of course,
yeah. And we've got one more tune. What have you chosen?
Yeah. Well, I've chosen, the last song is Rebel Girl by Bikini Kill. And I think it's just indicative of the fact, like the political power of music. I believe that all art is political. And whether it's escapist bread and circuses, or whether it's didactic screeds, you know, set to hip hop beats, that all music can have a profound meaning if you let it in. And Bikini Kill is certainly what, you know, in the link of chain of bands with purpose that fans don't just enjoy, they believe in. They're certainly one of the links in that chain. And I want to play this song because it's also, you know, how the personal can be political, and how like asserting your identity, you know, whether it's a political identity, whether it's a sexual identity, whatever, it can be a really liberating thing. And music can unlock that. And music can provide, like for me, it was bands like the Public Enemy and the Clash that provided a, I was in a conservative suburb in Illinois, and they made me realize I was not alone, and that there were ideas that were beyond the ideas that were in the classroom I was currently sitting in. And there was a community. I didn't know any of them personally, but there was a community that I heard via record that I knew that it pointed a way to, there might be some way that I can affect the world, and I can change things, and perhaps I'm an agent of history, like the same people that are making these records, you know? They're just people too, like me, but they live somewhere else, but we have the same, like, commonality of vision and ideas, and that's when music at its best can really do that. And this song is indicative of that. The world is not going to change itself. That's up to you, and dangerous truths will often be revealed in punk rock songs like Rebel Girl by Bikini Kill.
Of my guest on BBC Radio 6 Music today, Tom Morello, Bikini Kill, of course, with Rebel Girl. And so many people tweeting to say just how much they love that conversation. Eponymous Bob says, Tom Morello picking Go Google Bordello on 6 Music. It's just everything. Jeff in Sheffield absolutely loved Tom's choices. So did Dominic Walsh. He says, so good to listen to Tom. Prophets were stunning in Manchester playing live this week. Ross Musgrove has been in touch. He says, Tom Morello being interviewed on 6, it's just brilliant. And a lovely message here too from the boy Murray, who says, the beauty of Tom Morello is that throughout his career he's never once compromised his outlook towards inclusivity and his continuing mission to bring us all together. I watched him have 40,000 people eating out of the palm of his hand in London in June this year, including me. Absolutely stunning. Anyway, we're back with music from Quantic, from the XX, and from Andy Hart too in just a few moments. But first, we're going to check the news with Claire.